in for another week. I wanted to first give a shout out. Thank you. There are a few new subscribers over the past week, and thank you so much for watching. I'm just doing this really for fun, and it's really super cool to chat about cool places that I've been, and to know that anyone actually wants to watch it in the first place makes me feel really happy. So thank you so much. I hope that you enjoy my content for weeks to come. I'll try not to let you down. Okay, so after last week, I did go see Hereditary, and I'm gonna first say, I'm not sure where some of the haterade comes from for this film. I thought it was incredible. I really left the theater feeling awful in the best way possible. My friend and I went to go see it in the afternoon. We didn't stop talking about it for like 2 hours after we were done watching it, and then for days we were texting about things in the movie. I will not spoil anything here because I am not a jerk. I know there's plenty of people who have not yet seen this film, but I will say, go get your butt to the theater and see this. See it in the theater. I personally think it's a great theater film, and it was nice to hear some of the gasps from people around me when I was watching this movie. So it kind of inspired this week because it made me think that I really love any kind of a paranormal or supernatural kind of story. So if you give me a ghost story, a possession, anything like that, and I am all in. I grew up watching a lot of slasher movies, but the ones that, you know, the movies that always kind of like stuck in the back of my head were the paranormal kinds of movies, were, you know, the possession kinds of movies. So like The Exorcist, I mean, terrified me for years for sure. When I was little, I was really scared of Freddy Krueger because there's a funny story behind that. Maybe one time I'll tell you. I think the first movie I ever saw that really scared me, really, really scared me, was Pet Sematary. And it, you know, back then it was the sister Zelda that really scared me. But then as the years went by and I watched it more as an adult, I think actually Pascal is, or Pat's cow, as his daughter likes to call it, was the one that really scared me the most. It's a movie that kind of really, you know, sucks you in because you can understand where this guy is coming from in a point of grief, how you can do crazy things and open yourself up to something supernatural. So movies like that, and Poltergeist, and, more recent films like the Insidious films and the Conjuring films, those are the ones that stick in my head when I am laying down in bed at night and my mind decides to think of terrible, awful, terrifying things. Those are the things that I think about. You think of that scary demon in the corner, or Emily Rose, twitching and convulsing, and I don't know, doing all kinds of horrifying things. So that's the kind of stuff that sticks with me. And so it got me thinking about just how much I love paranormal places. I watch a ton of ghost shows. I always stay on the side of skepticism, but I'm open to things. I think, much like Mulder, I want to believe. And so I enjoy going places that have any kind of a supernatural lore to them. And I was thrilled a few months back to go to the Haunted Museum in Las Vegas. Okay, so let's go on a paranormal journey here to Las Vegas, Nevada. Right outside of the Strip and right outside the, the hustle and bustle, it's in downtown Las Vegas, and it is owned by Zak Bagans, who you may know from Ghost Adventures on the Travel Channel. So Zak has been collecting all of these different paranormal artifacts, and he decided to put them together on display in this place, and I have to say, I didn't know really like what to expect before I got there. It just sounded like something that I would be into. He did an amazing job with this place. Like, seriously, kudos to him, because it's not only the ambiance of the entire place. When you pull up, you're walking into somewhere spooky. It's, that Victorian style, definitely looks like dark. And when I got there, I was lucky because I've read, reviews from other people, and they said that they had to go and like wait a long time. I went on a weeknight, and it was myself and my friend and two other women. We went together. that was it. There was no people there. It was like a Monday or maybe not a Monday. I feel like they're closed on Mondays. So I'll post their information at the end of this video so you can check that out for yourself. But I know that it was a weeknight. So let's say it was like a Tuesday or a Wednesday, whatever it may have been. We didn't have a wait just to get our tour guide and, you know, get our tickets. And so a couple of things about this museum that I am going to just give a disclaimer here. So this is a paranormal museum that also has true crime artifacts. So I will say, if you're sensitive to certain things, you may not want to go here. You know, if you are afraid of dolls or puppets, do not go here. You will freak out. There are lots of them. I'll talk a little bit about that now, but you know, there's a lot of things there to get under people's skin in different ways, which I think is very clever, because it's not just, you know, okay, we believe that this object is haunted. It is, you know, this is artifacts from things that really happened, and here's photographs, and here's this, and, you know, lots of different ways to kind of get under your skin. So, okay, so you get there, you get a tour guide. Ticket price was like in the mid 30s. Zach was there when I went. I didn't get to chat with him or anything, but he was there like walking around, which is cool because it goes to show that you're, you know, putting a lot of pride into your exhibits. So kudos to you. I have my ticket here, and it's been like hanging on my fridge since I came back a few months ago. And I wanted to show you this ticket, not for, you know, oh, whoa, here's my ticket, but because there's a couple things right on here. When you get your ticket, it says you're not allowed to video record. There's no photography. There's no videography. There is no ghost hunting equipment allowed in this place. And there's no children allowed in this place. I believe it's under 16. It's either 16 or 18, not allowed. Even with a parent, nope, can't bring your kids. So that's a good thing for you to know if you're traveling there. There is some stuff in here that's seriously spooky, so, you know, it's probably better that way. I, you know, have a love-hate relationship with places that don't let you take, you know, photos, because I like to have them for myself. I always think that it's nice to look back on those memories and, you know, but at the same time, there's so much to see in an exhibit like this that I feel like, you know, if people were taking pictures, it would like kind of take away from the time that you were learning about why these pieces were there. So I'm totally okay with it. But there's a very interesting warning on your ticket. And actually there's warnings posted when you walk in the building, and there's a blessing station when you walk in the building. If you are a believer, if you, you know, if you have religious beliefs, and you know, it says on your ticket, "This building is known to contain ghosts and spirits and cursed objects. By entering, you agree that management will not be liable for any actions by these unseen forces. Touching of artifacts is extremely forbidden and will result in an immediate end to your tour. Thieves will be prosecuted to the full extent of the law and succumb to any angry spirit's curse." It says this right on your ticket. You know, and it says you have to sign, like they have a waiver there, basically saying like, hey, we're gonna take you to see some stuff that is known to like possess people or haunt people, and like if something follows you home, we are not responsible for that. So, you know, and we're not talking like haunted mansion, friendly hitchhiking ghosts kind of thing. It's supposed to be some really nasty stuff. So, you know, take that as you will, but that is a disclaimer when you go in there. Okay, so now we get our tour guide, and we start touring these 30 plus rooms of this, you know, of this exhibit. And they have exhibits that are like, let's say there's one room that's a chapel and they have human skeletons out in open coffins, which is really interesting to see. And some of them were, I mean, I forget exactly how old they were. And this is where pictures would come in handy for me, because sometimes like when I take a photo like that, I'll like make a note of, you know, I like to print them sometimes and keep them. I know I'm old fashioned. I like having things to look at. I'm the same way with physical media. you know, they have some human skeletons there on display, which is really neat to see. In that chapel, you can actually get married. And they said that it was one of many places you could get married in the museum, which I thought was really cool. So they have that. And what's interesting is each room tells a story, you know, like many museums do, but they have different speakers in certain rooms, which I think is interesting to tell you more detail on some of the artifacts that you're seeing. So, very cool. Okay, so we have two sides to this museum. We have the paranormal side, and then we have the true crime side. And if there is anything that parallels my love for Halloween and spookiness, it is my interest in true crime. I am really into true crime reading, podcasts. I watched more episodes of Forensic Files than I could care to admit. We just finished watching The Staircase. I'll leave my thoughts about that one out of this video, because that could be a whole video in itself. But so of course, you know, the fact that they had any true crime items on display, I was really excited for, because the only place I've ever gone before where I've seen extensive collection of true crime memorabilia was the Museum of Death in California, which in turn deserves its own episode, because that place will haunt your nightmares forever. So Zak has a room set up that it's kind of like, it's, I don't want to just say it's serial killers, because I feel like some of them were just killers, not serial killers, you know, like, but all different murder memorabilia, including mugshots, of different famous murderers around the room, and handwritten letters, drawings, paintings, clothing, costuming. Use your imagination here. We're talking like, the big, most notorious serial killers. So he recently acquired a whole bunch of stuff from Charles Manson after his passing. So he has like his prison uniform and his teeth there on exhibit, his television set, just a lot of different stuff there. That room, I could have spent 2 hours alone in that room, because I really wanted to see everything in detail. Obviously, like, it's timed, you can't, you know, go in there forever, but it's exciting to me, because then it's more of a reason to go back and like kind of catch some of those things that I couldn't catch, like every little detail the first time. So that room was like super fascinating to me. Tons of true crime memorabilia in there. And in talking with my tour guide, she was really into true crime too. She was also a murderino. So hey, stay sexy if you're a murderino watching this. We were chatting a little bit about some of her favorite exhibits, and of course this was at the top of the list. And so this room, you know, is kind of overwhelming with all of the details, and I thought that would be the extent of the true crime stuff that Zak had, but I was completely wrong. Go into another room, and I'm getting chills like up my body just reimagining my reaction when I first walked into this room. It looks like a barn when you walk inside, and it's a exhibit about Ed Gein that actually has his cauldron in the middle of the room. And so it was incredible. It was absolutely incredible to see this. He also had his shovel up on the wall. So Ed Gein, who, and for anybody who doesn't know who he is, he was somebody who was a very sick individual. He used to murder people and use their skin to make things like furniture and clothing of sorts. You can find tons of information about him. I'm going to put some recommended reading at the end of this video too, because Ed Gein is, he's a very fascinating killer, and he was a very, very sick man, and he was the inspiration for lots of different movie monsters, in terms of not Godzilla kind of monsters, but you know, like your Buffalo Bill kind of Silence of the Lambs monsters. And so that was very interesting to see. I've never seen anything of his before, and to see it out and open and know, what kind of things happen there. It gets under your skin. You know, it's really something that if you're into true crime, you would be like, whoa. And even if you're not, you'd probably just be super fascinated or kind of want to barf. I'm not sure, you know, either way. But I found it, you know, obviously super interesting. One more thing that he had on the true crime front that I will never forget this as long as I live. He had actually acquired Dr. Kevorkian's death fan, and he has it in a room opened up so you can see exactly what it looked like when he was administering the induced deaths to these patients. And My favorite thing about this actually was he didn't, like, with the true crime room and with the Ed Gein room, well, the true crime room is more like it was kind of like walking into an episode of Forensic Files, you know, and the Ed Gein room had a spooky aspect to it because, you know, let's face it, it's a very scary thing, right? But the Dr. Kevorkian room, he actually set it up as like kind of a memorial, which I thought was really great. So there's information there about, there's all the names of all of the people who decided to end their lives in that van, and they give you the opportunity to like pay your respects, which I thought was really awesome. So thanks for doing that. It's a really nice way to honor their families and everything too. So that part was really great. All right, so true crime stuff. You know, definitely, you know, sparking my interest. But now let's get into some of the spooky time stuff. So, all right. I mentioned here, if you're scared of dolls, please don't go here. And I'm not kidding. There is a puppet room I'm not scared of dolls. I don't like them particularly. Like, I find them to be like a little like, ugh, I don't know. You know, did you ever see that movie, The Boy? Like, Brahms, I hate you. They have this puppeteer room, like this, it's like a stage setup, and all of these are known to be haunted and move on their own. We didn't see any movement when we were there, but I have to be honest, I'm glad I didn't see any of them move because they're creepy, just hang in there. And the whole room, you're just like surrounded by them, and like they point out specific ones that like are more active than others. So definitely the dolls, like they had a doll that was at the bottom of a staircase going into the basement. They said that it's like closed off, but you can see the doll like looking up at you from the bottom of the staircase, and I think that would kind of make anybody uneasy. I was like, ooh, as I was walking by, I was like, okay, I'm kind of glad we're not going down there. I don't want to look at her. They did have Peggy, the doll there too, which I didn't know about her until after I had gone to the museum, so it was cool to kind of learn something new, that she is known notoriously to create chest pains and nausea and massive headaches, that she's been known to like cause heart attacks and strokes in people. So you can actually go see her. They have a really closed room. The tour guide would not go in some of these rooms with us. So they would tell you and like kind of stand at the doorway because they were like, I don't like going in here. It makes me feel uncomfortable. So, you know, as you're going in, it's like each room is its own nightmare. And one interesting piece that Zach had there was the Dybbuk box. You may have known about it if you saw the movie The Possession with Jeffrey Dean Morgan. And, you know, this box is thought to contain a very, like, malevolent spirit. And they have, like, a thing there, like, if you leave something of yours, it's, like, won't try to attach itself to you, is, like, what they say. So I wasn't taking any chances. I left a little something there, of course. I think I left, like, my chapstick or something. But, you know, definitely really, really creepy and really, you know, even if you're not a believer, just getting lost in the storytelling of it is enough to like kind of put chills up your spine. He did also have some other interesting exhibits, like the stairs from the Demon House. He had photos of a woman that were taken. They were supposedly taken within minutes of each other, and you like see her looking like more and more possessed. She died, and you can see all of her like paranormal equipment. She used to like, you know, try to speak to the other side, and it was very reminiscent of like Lin Shaye in Insidious when she puts on the, you know, that mask, and like she has like that voice, you know, and she's like whispering to her guys to like write down the, you know, like what she's hearing from the other side. Very, very reminiscent of, super creepy in itself. So there was, you know, there was that. There's also this part of the exhibit really blew me away. He has a lot of death artifacts from famous people. So he had like Michael Jackson's, the chair that Michael Jackson was found in, and like the pill bottles, like the empty pill bottles and stuff. He had like from like Truman Capote. And I mean, there's just a lot, there's a lot to see there. And, then he also has like a super spooky, like, carnival, like a haunted carnival setup. So there's one room that's like all like a mini carnival. You can see like all the little pieces. It's like kind of like a Lemax Spooky Town almost, but it's like all like it was all made by this one guy, and it's set. It takes up an entire room. It's humongous. The way that he displayed it is incredible. And he threw one piece in there. They'll tell you about it if you go on the tour. I won't spoil it for you, but you have to kind of, they make you look for it, so it's really fun. They have like a clown, like a haunted clown house, like kind of set up, and that part is like a haunted house with like strobe lights and you know, people popping out at you. It was really fun. They have things about Circus Sideshow. I mean, there's just so much to see at this place. I really, like I said, I went like kind of not expecting to be blown away the way that I was. So great job, amazing place. I definitely say this place should go on the top of like your spookometer list if you are visiting Las Vegas and you like don't want to just sit at the casino all day. This is where you should go. You should definitely check it out. I'm going to link the information at the end of the credits there, so keep an eye out for that. And I'll post, you know, also in the comment section, just in case anybody's interested in learning more. And if you have been there, let's chat it up. I want to know about your experience there. Tell me about what exhibits you really enjoyed. You know, I can't wait to get back to this place. And oh my goodness, I almost forgot to tell you one of my favorite parts of this museum. Okay, so see, I got so lost in the true crime, I almost forgot to tell you about like incorporating horror and in this museum. Was like my brain was gonna explode. You walk into this one room and they had like haunted paintings and you know all this. And they had Bela Lugosi's scrying mirror. So Bela Lugosi was a big paranormal enthusiast, and scrying was a form of like communication with the dead. They thought they could see like, you know, they thought they could see the other side, so to speak. And so they have it hanging in a room with a curtain over it, and you could choose whether you wanted to look in it or not, and they gave you like plenty of time to like actually stand there and look. I didn't see Bella. It would be awesome if I saw him. Funny Bella story. At his wake, Vincent Price, I want to say that I don't remember who he was talking to, but I recall that the story goes that Vincent Price at Bela Lugosi's funeral said, "Should we stake him just in case?" I'm gonna post information, if you have gone, be sure to let me know what your experience was like. And if you're enjoying my content so far, please like, comment, subscribe, so I can keep this going. And until next week, stay spooky, and I'll see you soon. Bye.